Good morning, everyone. Welcome to St. Paul's Worship Service this morning. Glad you're with us on this warm summer day. Our invocation this morning comes from the Book of Common Prayer. Would you please pray with me? O Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Worship the King, glorious above, gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy is space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form. Dark is his path on the wings of the storm. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? Breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Children of dust, and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our maker, defender, redeemer, and friend. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our maker, defender, redeemer, and friend. In the stillness, I know that you are God. In the secret of your presence, I know that I am restored. When you call, I won't refuse. Each new day again I'll choose. There is no one else for me, none but Jesus, crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise. In the chaos, in confusion, I know your sovereign still. In the moment of my weakness, you give me grace to do your will. When you call, I won't delay. This my song through all my days. A
There is no one else for me, none but Jesus, crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise, and all my delight is in you, Lord. All of my hope, all of my strength, all my delight is in you, Lord, forevermore. And all my delight is in you, Lord, all of my hope, all of my strength, and all my delight is in you, Lord, forevermore, forevermore. There is no one else for me, none but Jesus, crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise, and all your hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. No other Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you've found.
Amen. Hey, Ryan.
Hey, Steve.
Morning to you, too.
Siri just started talking to me, so sorry about that.
Oh, did I ask a question?
No. When I said, hey, Steve, Siri heard me, and so Siri started talking to me, so.
Well, you guys have a good time.
You heard my Siri.
Have a good time. We'll catch you later.
All right. Thank you, Steve. All right. Good morning, St. Paul's. I guess I'll start with a quick health update. Things are actually pretty much the same as last week. Shortly after our service last Sunday, we went to go have Sarah tested for COVID, and we still haven't received the results. So they said it would take 6 to 10 days. We're in day 7 now. So we'll see, but she's doing fine. She still has a few mild symptoms of what could possibly be COVID. So we're trying to be extra careful. We know that if whatever she does have, I'm obviously carrying too. And so we made the decision once again to not do in-person worship this week. But we're feeling good. We appreciate your prayers and concern. And we'll keep you updated on the results when we get them. And we'll be making the decision sometime this week about whether returning to in-person worship is appropriate. So. Well, if you've been with us over the last several weeks, you know that we haven't really been in a sermon series. We finished our last sermon series on the Sermon on the Mount 3 weeks ago now, and we're going to start a new sermon series eventually. But since then, I've just kind of been preaching on whatever passage the Lord lays on my heart in any given week. And the passage that I kept having impressed upon me this week was from Matthew chapter 12, starting in verse 22. So if you have a Bible, I encourage you to turn there, Matthew 12, starting in verse 22. Why don't we say a quick prayer before we get into this? Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for this beautiful summer morning. And we thank you for the chance to gather in this virtual way. We just pray that you would anoint our time together with your Holy Spirit, that you would direct our thoughts and focus our attention on your word, and that you would speak to us through it, Lord. We give you thanks for this morning, and in Jesus' name, amen. I'm noticing that there's some road noise that you might be able to hear, and I hope it's not too distracting. If it is too distracting, Keith, I know you're watching, just send me a quick text so that I can hopefully adjust in some way. So I will read this passage and then I'll explain why I've been thinking about it a lot this week, because the meaning might not be immediately obvious. So Matthew 12, starting in verse 22. Then they brought him a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute, and Jesus healed him so that he could both talk and see. All the people were astonished and said, "Could this be the son of David?" But when the Pharisees heard this, they said, "It is only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons." Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined. and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. If Satan drives out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then can his kingdom stand? And if I drive out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your people drive them out? So then they will be your judges. But if I drive out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Or again, how can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can rob his house. So Jesus is performing miraculous healings, including freeing people from demon possession. And the results are very powerful, right? People who are blind are able to see, people who are deaf are able to hear, people who have been unable to speak are now able to speak. And most of the people who are observing what Jesus is doing are amazed. And they're saying, could this be the Son of David? In other words, could this be the long-awaited Messiah that's been prophesied for centuries? Could this be the guy that we've been waiting for who will set things right with the world and establish the kingdom of God? So that's the way most of the ordinary folks are reacting. But there are some people who are reacting differently. We're told that the Pharisees, who were the religious leaders at the time, are interpreting these events very differently. They said, well, if Jesus is casting out demons, it must be by the power of the devil that he's doing that. So, in other words, what they were saying was, this must be some kind of trick that Jesus is playing and that the devil is playing through Jesus. The devil must be instructing his demons to leave the people they're possessing in order to make Jesus look good. Because Jesus is actually a false prophet, and if Jesus looks good, then he'll be able to lead the people astray. So one way of putting it is that the Pharisees explained what was going on with a conspiracy theory, right? They said, what seems to be happening is not what's actually happening. Jesus isn't a good guy. He's a bad guy. His power doesn't come from God. It comes from the devil. And this is all just a trick to lead you astray. Conspiracy theory. Now, why did the Pharisees promote a conspiracy theory? Was it because they really believed it? Did they really believe that Jesus was in cahoots with the devil? Well, we don't know for sure what they really believed. Maybe some of them really did believe that. Maybe they didn't, and they just wanted to confuse the people. Maybe they didn't really believe it at first, but after they kept repeating it, they started to actually think it was true. We don't know for sure. But here's what we do know, okay? The Pharisees' promotion of this conspiracy theory had nothing to do with evidence. Pharisees' promotion of this conspiracy theory had nothing to do with actual evidence. We could argue that what they were saying was a possible explanation of what was going on, but it definitely wasn't a reasonable explanation of what was going on. You know, a possible explanation for the experience you're having right now is that you are the only mind in the universe, and everything else that you're perceiving is an illusion. And all of your memories were actually downloaded into your brain a second ago, and you've only existed for 1 second. That is a possible explanation of reality. But is it a reasonable one? No. And there's no real evidence for it. It's completely unfalsifiable, right? And that's the kind of explanation that the Pharisees are giving right now. This is an explanation that is unfalsifiable. There's no real evidence for it, but it's just a possible explanation. If you see someone who's going up to people who are blind and unable to speak and commanding demons to leave, and then they're able to see and they're able to speak, the reasonable conclusion from that set of data is not the healer is in cahoots with the demons, right? That explanation is needlessly complex. If you're familiar at all with the philosophical principle of Occam's razor, you know that explanation is definitely not in keeping with Occam's razor, right? A much simpler, more reasonable explanation is that this healer has authority over the demons, and that his power and intention is actually in opposition to the demons, not somehow working in cahoots with them. So, the Pharisees' promotion of this conspiracy theory has nothing to do with evidence. So what does it have to do with? It has to do with what the Pharisees want to be true. The Pharisees are people of power and influence, and they want to keep that power. The Pharisees are prideful people, and they want to protect their pride. But the thing is, Jesus is saying and doing things that challenge their power and their pride, and that critique the whole religious establishment. If you're familiar with the Gospels, you know that Jesus regularly confronted the religious authorities. There was nobody in society that he had more criticism for than the religious authorities at that time. He critiqued their intentions. He critiqued their interpretations of the law. He critiqued their faithfulness to God. And so the Pharisees don't want Jesus to be sent from God. They don't want him to be right. They don't want him to be the Messiah who's bringing the kingdom of God. Because if he's right, then they need to repent. If he's right, they need to humble themselves. And nobody wants to do that, right? And so keep that in mind. This is the way you're thinking if you're a Pharisee. And then they get the news, right? This teacher who has critiqued you is doing incredible miracles. He's freeing people who are in spiritual bondage. The blind are seeing, the deaf are hearing, the mute are speaking. This is not news that is going to make you go, oh, yay, that's wonderful, right? Because this news threatens their pride. And so when they get this news, their brains have to come up with a way of explaining this information, of interpreting it, that allows them to protect their pride, right? And the thing that enables them to do that is this conspiracy theory. There's no evidence for this conspiracy theory, but the conspiracy theory allows them to keep thinking what they want to think. It's a possible explanation that fits the narrative that they want to promote, not a reasonable explanation, but a possible one. And so they latch onto it. So what is my point? Well, what I want us to see here is that this is an example of how much our own pride and our own desires can influence the way we see the world. I'll say that again. This is an example of how much our own pride and our own desires can influence the way that we see the world. As human beings, we have this endless capacity to interpret the world in ways that boost our own ego. You know, an example I like to give is from my experience in college and in high school, watching the way students react to their grades. You know, if a student gets a good grade, usually what they think is, yes, you know, I did a great job, I worked hard, I'm smart. But if they get a bad grade, usually the first thing they'll say is, oh, well, that teacher was awful, right? Rarely do they do the reverse, where if they get a good grade, their first comment is, oh, well, I just had such an awesome teacher. You know, and if they get a bad grade, they say, well, that's on me. That's my fault. See, we have this tendency to interpret the world in ways that boost our own ego and that make us feel proud. Now, as an aside, I know that some of us struggle very much with a negative self-concept, and maybe we interpret everything in a way that makes us feel worse about ourselves. And so this may not apply to you. But generally speaking, many of us have this tendency to gravitate towards explanations of reality that preserve our pride and our ego. Now, obviously, this has always been true throughout history. But I think because of the world that we're living in right now, this tendency is leading to a full-blown crisis. And it's what you might call a crisis of epistemology. Now, what is epistemology? Epistemology is the branch of philosophy that deals with the question, how can we know what is true? And so to say that we as a society are experiencing a crisis of epistemology is to say, not only are we struggling to agree on what's true, we're struggling on how to even know what's true. We're not agreeing on which institutions are reliable. We're not agreeing on which news sources are trustworthy. We're not agreeing on which things are facts and which things are opinions. We're not agreeing on how much stock to put on science and on the medical community and all that kind of thing. And there are people who are really describing this moment that we're in as a true crisis of epistemology. And I believe that one of the things that is at the root of this epistemic crisis is the same impulse that led the Pharisees to say that Jesus was in cahoots with Satan. And what it is that all of us have ways that we want to look at the world, ways that appeal to our pride and our ego. You know, if we identify as a Republican, we want to interpret the news and the world around us in ways that make us feel good about ourselves and our identity as a Republican. Same thing with if we identify as a Democrat, right? We want to interpret the news and the world around us in ways that make us feel good as a Democrat. If we're not very educated, we want to interpret the world in ways that make us feel like we are just as capable as those who are educated, even if we're commenting on things that we just are not our field, right? Whatever labels we have incorporated into our own identity, we want to interpret the world in ways that make us feel good about that identity. Make sense? Now, think about what happens when we combine this human tendency with the rise of the information age and the internet. You know, you don't need a publishing contract anymore to get your ideas out into the world. You just need an internet connection. And you don't need to go visit some big library in order to find out all the various views that exist out there in the world. All you need is an internet connection. And so now it is easier than ever before in history for you to believe whatever you want to believe, because you can go online and find a group of people who believe what you want to believe. Right? It doesn't matter how out there your views are, you will be able to find a community of people who will support you in your belief and reinforce you in that belief. I mean, there are people out there who believe everything under the sun. There's always somebody who believes a crazy idea, right? More than one somebody. And now because of the internet, those people can find each other and reinforce those beliefs and spread them. You know, I bet that if Jesus had been ministering during the time of the internet, I think these Pharisees would be promoting this conspiracy theory all over the web, this conspiracy theory that Jesus is actually in cahoots with Satan. And I bet that they would persuade a lot of people of that view, you know, especially the people who had, for whatever reason, incorporated the Pharisees into their identity. You know, maybe they just thought of themselves as Team Pharisee. I identify with the Pharisees' teaching. Those people would be particularly susceptible to this in cahoots with the devil theory. And I imagine that they would gather together iPhone videos of Jesus preaching, and they would look in those videos and try to find hints of sinister activity. they would probably say things like, "Ooh, look at Jesus' fingers right there. If you pause it in that moment, it looks like he's flashing the pagan symbol for Baal, you know, or look at all the flies that are landing on him as he's teaching here. You know, that's a sign that his true father is the Lord of the flies, Beelzebub." And I imagine that some people would be very deceptive, and they would manipulate videos of Jesus so that he seemed incoherent or out of his mind. And they would say, "See, this is evidence that he is actually possessed by the devil." And so there would be plenty of support for anyone who wanted to believe that Jesus was actually on the devil's team. And everyone who believed that or wanted to believe that would gather together in their online forums, and they would reinforce each other's beliefs, and they would even find a sense of community and belonging in sharing the same conspiracy theory about Jesus. And my exhortation for us this morning as the church is, don't be like the Pharisees. And you might say, "Well, Ryan, how are we like the Pharisees? Obviously, we don't believe that Jesus is in cahoots with Satan." And of course, we don't believe that. If we're in the church, that goes without saying. But like the Pharisees, we can still end up believing and promoting whatever appeals to our pride and our egos rather than what is actually true. I will say that again. Just like the Pharisees, we can end up believing and promoting whatever appeals to our pride and our desires rather than what is actually true. And it takes work to resist doing that. I don't think any human being does it perfectly. I think that we can end up believing things that are false, and we can hold those beliefs passionately without even realizing that the main reason we do that is really because of our pride, because there's something about believing that belief that protects our ego. Sometimes we're actually oblivious to that. And it takes work to be reflective enough to notice that. But part of being a disciple of Jesus is learning to think well. You know, Jesus said, "The greatest commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." And we have to remember that mind part, right? And we don't love the Lord with all of our minds if we don't use the minds that he's given us well. And we're not using our minds well when we allow our pride and our desire to dictate which information we trust and which information we reject, right? That's not thinking well. Now, when Jesus responds to the Pharisees, he tries to get them to think well. He tries to reason with them. And he uses three arguments. So let's look at these quickly. It might have been a little hard to understand Jesus' arguments, so I want us to examine them. So argument one, he says, "Every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined. And every city or household divided against itself will not stand. If Satan drives out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then can his kingdom stand?" What does Jesus mean here? Well, if I were to put his argument into my own words, I would say this. Why would Satan, whose goal is to steal, kill, and destroy, heal people? If he is possessing people, he's succeeding in stealing, killing, and destroying. So why would part of his plan involve restoring them and healing them and casting himself out of them? That just does not make any sense. He would be acting against his own interests, and so he would be divided against himself. And kingdoms that are divided against themselves do not succeed, right? They do not stand. So this just doesn't make sense. So that's Jesus's first attempt to get them to think well, right? The second argument he uses is my favorite one. Jesus says, "And if I drive out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your people drive them out?" And I love this one because what Jesus is doing is he's giving them a little bit of a taste of their own medicine. And he's basically saying, if I'm in cahoots with Satan, why would anyone assume that you're not in cahoots with Satan? I mean, you guys purport to drive out demons too. Religious authorities at least tried to do that, right? So he's saying, you're accusing me of something that you yourself are just as accusable of. So clearly this is not a good argument. This isn't even an argument. This is just an assertion. You guys aren't thinking well. This actually reminds me of Sigmund Freud, the psychoanalyst. He used to say that God is an illusion that people believe in because they have a deep desire for a loving father. And some people think that this is this great argument against the existence of God, that belief in God is just this wish projection, that we want a loving father, and so we believe in God. And a lot of people think that this is a great argument against the existence of God. But that's not a good argument against the existence of God, because that kind of argument could just as easily be turned around and used against atheism, right? Because one could say, Freud, the reason you don't believe in God is because you have a deep desire to be free of any authoritarian figure. See, that argument is just as reasonable as Freud's, and it's also just as unprovable. And it's a great response because it reveals the flaw in the original argument. And that's the same kind of thing that Jesus is doing with the Pharisees here. He's showing them that the argument they're using can just as easily be used against them. And that means it's a bad argument. Clever. So then finally, the third argument that Jesus gives, I think this one might be the most confusing. He says, or again, how can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can rob the house. So Jesus is arguing through an analogy here. And in the analogy, the strong man is the devil, and his possessions are the people that he has possessed. And the analogy Jesus is giving is, if you go to steal someone's possessions, you're not going to be able to do it unless the person you're stealing from is bound in some way, you know, unless they are tied up and rendered powerless. So similarly, if you are going to free people from demonic possession, the devil has to be tied up and rendered powerless. So it doesn't make sense to say Jesus is getting his power to free people from the devil, because the only way that people could be freed from the devil is if the devil is rendered powerless. Okay, so I know that's a little confusing, but you know, the essence of the argument is this: it is silly to think of the devil as empowering someone to take his stuff. You know, just as it would be silly to think that if you just showed up at somebody's house, they'd be like, sure, take all my possessions. It doesn't make sense. So Jesus tries to reason with the Pharisees. He tries to persuade them with logic. He encourages them to think carefully, you know, rather than just be guided by their pride. And I think what Jesus does here should encourage us in two ways. So one, it should be an encouragement to us to use our minds, to think carefully, to personally not just be guided by our pride in interpreting the world. And then two, it should encourage us to actually attempt to reason with people when they disagree with us. Jesus knows that the Pharisees are not acting rationally, but he still makes an effort to appeal to their reason. He still tries to persuade them. So there is a time and a place for doing that, you know, for reasoning with those whom we disagree with. But I want us to notice something. And that is that Jesus is aware of what's really driving the Pharisees' conspiracy theory. Because he says in verse 28, if you've got your Bible, look at it. He says, if I drive out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Now, why does he say that? He says that because he is acknowledging that if the Pharisees accept that his power comes from God, then they also need to recognize that he is the Messiah, that the kingdom of God is coming through him. And he knows that they don't want to do that. So Jesus is perceptive. He's recognizing the heart behind the conspiracy theory. He's not naive about where it's coming from. The heart behind the conspiracy theory is, I don't want to believe that Jesus is actually Lord. I don't want to believe that his critiques of the religious establishment are correct. So it is easier for me to believe that he gets his power from the devil. So Jesus knows what's actually going on in the Pharisees' hearts. And what I want us to recognize is that Jesus knows what's actually going on in our hearts too. He knows the emotions, the fears, and the pride that influence the way we see the world. And my encouragement for us this morning is to say to Jesus, Lord, free me from whatever is in my heart that keeps me from seeing the truth. Whatever the truth might be. Lord, free me from whatever is in my heart that blinds me to reality. Lord, free me from whatever is in my heart that keeps me from coming to you and trusting in you. Help me to see things the way you see them, Lord. Take my blinders off. So let's not be like the Pharisees. Let's seek the truth, not whatever feeds our egos. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, these are confusing times to be living in. There is so much information out there to sort through. There's so much misinformation to sort through. And Lord, as we seek truth, I pray that we would be guided primarily not by our pride, not by our selfish desires, but by your Spirit. God, grant us your wisdom. Help us not to be like the Pharisees. We give you thanks, Lord, for the wisdom that you do promise to give us when we ask sincerely. Lord, guide us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. So I am going to play a reflection song and then we're going to do communion. And we've been doing communion on live stream for several months now. And if that seems a little bit weird to you, I encourage you to go to our website where there's a section where you can read about why we made that decision to do communion even though we're apart. But the essence of the reason for the decision is because we believe that in practicing communion, we are affirming that we are still the body of Christ, we are still united through Christ, even when we are separated by time and space. So if you would like to participate in communion and you haven't done it with us before, we encourage you right now as I play this reflection song, to gather something in your home that can represent the elements. You know, obviously, if you have bread or juice or wine, that is ideal. But if, you know, you need to get creative, that's fine too. So find something akin to the elements. Thank you. search my heart and search my soul. There's nothing else that I want more. Shine your light and show your face in my life. Lord, have your way. So with all my heart and with all my soul, with all I am, Lord, I will follow you. You took the cross, you took all my shame, restored my life. Now I live to worship you. My cry and hear my prayer. Draw me close, I know you're near. Give me strength and give me grace to walk with you, Lord, all my days. So with all my heart, with all my soul, with all I am, Lord, I will follow you. You took the cross, took all my shame, restored my life. Now I live to worship you. Without you, I am nothing. 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 So throughout the message, I've talked about how we need to let go of our pride and ego so that we can see the world as it actually is, so that we can seek the truth clearly. But it's really hard to get past our own pride and our own ego. So how do we do that? Well, one of the things that helps to free us from our pride and ego is the basic message of the gospel, which is that despite our flaws, God loves us and God has accepted us. You know, we don't have to justify ourselves through our own pride and through being right all the time and that sort of thing, because God has justified us through Jesus. God has declared that we are valuable and that he loves us, and we can rest secure in that. And the reason we can rest secure is because of, you know, what we remember and celebrate with communion, which is that Jesus gave his life, his earthly life, his body and his blood, and suffered on our behalf in order to reconcile us to God. And when we remember his suffering, when we remember his sacrifice, that should remind us we are justified. We don't need to justify ourselves. We don't need to be obsessed with satisfying our pride and our ego. So I encourage you to think of that as you receive communion this morning. I don't need to obsess over justifying myself, being right all the time, making sure that whatever teams I've aligned myself with are, you know, considered correct. I can rest secure in knowing that I belong to Jesus. So the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you declare the Lord's death until he comes again."
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh, you would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh, you all that you've done for me. No. All that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Oh, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh, you would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. That you've done for me.
Amen. Thank you so much for joining us on the live stream. Stay tuned for more news this week on whether we'll resume in-person worship. I thank you again for your thoughts and prayers and concern about our health. And I'll be praying that you guys all stay healthy as well. Let's say our benediction. While our service has now ended, our worship has not ended, because our worship never ends. Now, go in peace to love and serve the Lord and to love and serve his people. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you.